Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the U.S. Pavilion. We are so happy to have you here with us today. The U.S. Pavilion here at the World Conservation Congress is a public diplomacy initiative through the U.S. Department of State based in Washington, D.C. I'd like to recognize the U.S. Center or U.S. Pavilion Director, Isabel Gates, again, because she's so wonderful, and we've been so thrilled to have such a wonderful and professional few days here with you. Thanks, Isabel. Sorry to embarrass you. It's my pleasure and my honor to introduce the next program. It's called Landscape Conservation Cooperatives in Action, and we've got a really interesting lineup of speakers. We've got somebody coming in from afar, so you're in for a special treat. I'd like to introduce the moderator of the program, Laura McLean, comes to us from the United States Fish and Wildlife Service. She is the communications manager for science applications and is also the communications coordinator of the National Landscape Conservation Cooperative Network. So I'd like to welcome you to the stage, and thanks again for being here.
Thank you, everybody. Aloha. Isn't that a great word? Gosh, the whole time that I've been here, I just feel it building and building. And it's really, I've come to value the word as a gathering place, or as a gathering word that connects people together. And I hope over the next course of the hour, or the next hour, you'll feel that same essence and that same sense of gathering, of people coming together to make a difference. And the landscape conservation cooperatives really are a gathering place for the stewards of natural and cultural resources to come together to tackle some of the biggest conservation issues of our day. So climate change, ecological connectivity, urbanization, and resiliency, whether within for our natural resources, for our coasts, or for our communities. But first, before we kind of start our tour here today, I want to briefly introduce our tour guides, and we have four folks joining us today. Here in the pavilion, live in person, are Deanna Spooner and Stanton Enomoto with the Pacific Islands Climate Change Cooperative. And via Google Hangout, remotely, are Cynthia Kaleo-Edwards from the Southeast Conservation Adaptation Strategy, and Aaron Poe of the Aleutian and Bering Sea Islands LCC. And I'll tell you a little bit more about their background once we get to their tour stops. And then driving the tech for our presentation today is Patrick Grady, and he's right there. And he is the GIS and data manager for the Pacific Islands Climate Change Cooperative and the Pacific Islands Climate Science Center. So thank you, Patrick, for driving the bus here. And so as we go along, please feel free after each tour stop, if you have a question to ask, we will entertain your questions. But we're also saving time at the end to kind of have a more greater dialogue and conversation about landscape conservation and the LCCs, as we refer to the landscape conservation cooperatives. So I feel like at this point, you know, as your tour guide, your moderator, tour guide, I should say, please keep your hands inside the car at all times, but keep your minds open to what we're going to talk about this morning. And so as our kind of introduction, I guess I should first tell you, what is a landscape conservation cooperative? And really, it embodies the two concepts that we've heard throughout this IUCN Congress, which is scaling up conservation and conservation beyond boundaries. And that exactly describes an LCC. So Patrick's going to pull up one of our story maps here for the South Atlantic LCC so we can see one in action. And an LCC is a self-directed applied science partnership that brings together federal, state, local, international governments, tribes and First Nations, universities, NGOs, and other community or other types of organizations together, who really have a stake in what's happening in the places around them, in the places that they care so deeply about. And so these partners come together to identify their shared conservation priorities, and then they do something about it. How great is that? They do something about it. They come together, the aloha spirit. And an LCC is not defined by jurisdictional boundaries. It's defined by the landscape and the collaborators. And through the LCC, partners collaborate to connect their efforts to meet unfilled science needs and to make sure they're not duplicating efforts, because as we all know, resources are scarce these days and we have to do more with less. And so as you can see on the screen here, the top priority for the South Atlantic LCC, and I'll face this way so I don't lose the mic here, is to create a living spatial plan for that Southeast part of the United States. And this is what they call their conservation blueprint. And within the blueprint, we kind of started this coarse layer, and you can dive finer and finer into looking at what are these places and what's happening on the landscape. And they really bring their partners together to think about what is the future for where we live in these places and species that we care about. And so an LCC's voluntary steering committee selects projects like the South Atlantic LCC did for the conservation blueprint to support and fund that really help bridge this gap between research and management, planning and delivery on the ground. And so now that you know a little bit about what an LCC is, I'm gonna invite our next tour guide up to the podium, Deanna Spooner, who's gonna give you some background in history, because every good tour has a little history in it. And Deanna, as I mentioned, is the coordinator for the Pacific Islands Climate Change Cooperative. Deanna has worked on species conservation and climate change adaptation for the past 20 years. And with PICSI, she focuses on large-scale, partnership-driven climate adaptation planning and implementation for natural cultural resources. She sits on the steering committees of several regional climate change organizations and is a member of the IUCN Commission on Environmental, Economic, and Social Policy. Deanna.
Thank you, Laura. So I get to do the ancient history portion of the tour about the LCC network, the origin, the genesis that dates all the way back to 2009. So this was when the idea behind these cooperative partnerships took root within the United States Department of the Interior. And the Secretary of the Interior at that time said, "This is a great idea. We need to be doing conservation beyond boundaries, beyond jurisdictions. We need to be working public-private partnerships to tackle these really big issues that Laura touched upon." And so at that time, the Secretary of the Interior empowered the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service to launch this network, which turned into 22 connected LCCs. And over the years since 2009, this initiative has gathered hundreds of organizations into a connected network. There are government agencies, tribes and First Nations, non-governmental organizations, private landowners, businesses, academia, very, very expansive list. And despite the diversity of these partnerships and the ecosystems that you see in this network, and by the way, this network covers every ecosystem type that you can find within the globe. Despite that diversity, and despite the fact that each LCC is self-directed and each partnership determines what its priorities will be, we are connected as a network. So how do we achieve this? How do we connect 22 LCCs across a very large portion of the globe? We do that by developing a shared understanding of and approach to landscape scale conservation, the planning, the science, the design, the implementation, the monitoring. We share those tools and technologies across this network so that instead of replicating the same exercises, we can leapfrog over each other and really accelerate our learning. We facilitate the exchange of scientific information and technical tools and methodologies through a variety of mechanisms, including working groups, using tools like the Story Map and other online planning tools so that we can share information internationally. And then we also partner. Multiple LCCs will come together and partner on some large regional issues that are too big for even just one LCC to tackle. And perhaps most importantly, we get together as a community to share knowledge. We're a community of practice. Sometimes we get together virtually. You know, it's kind of hard to pull people together across a network this size in person on a frequent basis. So sometimes it's virtual, but occasionally we get together in person so we can rapidly build on the success and learn what's working, why. You know, why is it working in your part of the world? What has your partnership done to really accelerate your particular issue? And then we just keep building on that knowledge. So instead of telling you about what we do, you're going to now hear from the people who are actually doing some of this amazing work. So I'll turn the tour bus back over to Laura. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. So actually, our next stop is going to be with Cynthia Callio Edwards, who is joining us from Jackson, Mississippi. So good morning to you. Thank you for joining us at 1:30 in the morning, your time. Cynthia is the coordinator for the Southeast Conservation Adaptation Strategy, which brings together multiple LCCs, and she'll tell you some more about that. Cynthia previously served as a science coordinator for the Gulf Coast Prairie LCC, and her agricultural background and focus on the linkages between wildlife conservation and agriculture give her a unique foundation to pursue her interest in the conservation of natural resources and adaptation to climate change across North America. So Cynthia, it's your tour.
Thanks, Laura. Can you hear me all right?
We can.
Okay. So it's about 10:30 at night, 10:45, Jackson time, so a little later than I'm used to staying up. That's why I have this huge coffee cup with me. I'm really excited to be able to join you, albeit remotely, tonight to talk about the Southeast Conservation Adaptation Strategy. I don't have much time, so I'm going to try to focus on the why we're doing this conservation adaptation strategy at such a large scale across the Southeast. There's, like many other areas, the Southeast has a lot of pressures on it right now. 77 million people in the 15 states and growing faster than most other parts of the country right now. We've also got a lot of coastlines, so a lot of sea level rise issues, energy development, all of those things that go along with people on the landscape. And one of the reasons that people like the Southeast is it's a great place to live. We have excellent recreation opportunities. And one of the things we're trying to do through the adaptation strategy is keep this place a good place to live. So about 5 years ago, the directors of the Southeast Association of Fish and Wildlife Agency states, so the 15 states in the Southeast, decided that they wanted to develop a conservation vision for the future. So beginning to define what we need that landscape to look like for fish and wildlife resources. And how I like to refer to it is we don't want fish and wildlife resources to just get the leftovers after everyone else is done with the landscape. So we need to better define what it is that we need that landscape to look like. And that's where CECAS came in. So the 15 state directors invited our federal partners. So the 12 federal agencies that work with natural resources in the Southeast. So NOAA, I see their display in the background, Wildlife Service, of course, USGS, and a host of other partners to join them on this journey, so to speak. At the same time, about 5 years ago, as Deanna and Laura both touched on, the landscape conservation cooperatives were just being stood up. So they were identified as the entity where we would get this work done. So working on the blueprint, sort of what the landscape looks like now, working with partners to develop biological objectives, and all of those things that go into developing a conservation design, plus providing the actual conservation collaboration that's so important in the work that we do. So that's where CECAS came in. It's a collaborative approach to developing a shared vision for the future. And one of the first tangible products that came out of this effort and this new model of working collaboratively is the Gulf Coast Vulnerability Assessment. So Laura, if you could go to the next tab. Gulf Coast Vulnerability Assessment was identified as a need early on in the landscape conservation cooperative work in the Gulf. And really, the uniqueness of it comes in part because we wanted to look at the Gulf as a whole. And until this point in time, much of the work done on the Gulf of Mexico was done state by state. So those five states and jurisdictions across the Gulf rather than as a whole entity. And one of the ways that we started to identify the need to look Gulf-wide is all of the attention in the Gulf given the Deepwater Horizon oil spill back in 2010. So again, the landscape conservation cooperatives, and there's four of them that work across the Gulf, the Gulf Coast Prairie, Gulf Coastal Plains and Ozarks, the South Atlantic and Peninsula Florida, they all work together with their partnership to develop this Gulf Coast Vulnerability Assessment. We brought in other partners like NOAA, again, the Gulf of Mexico Alliance, and several universities to make this happen. So what the Gulf Coast Vulnerability Assessment really is an assessment of the vulnerability of four ecosystems and 11 associated species, and I'll touch on those in a minute. And it's a qualitative assessment of the relative vulnerability of those across the region. So we looked at six different ecoregions, beginning in, I guess, on the Texas side in Brownsville, Texas, all the way around to the Florida Keys, and divided those up. And then we looked at four ecosystems, so tidal emergent marsh, mangrove, barrier islands, and oyster reef, and a suite of species associated with those. And what the vulnerability assessment enabled us to process, we used, which is the standardized index of vulnerability and value assessment developed out of Florida, is it enabled us to take qualitative information from a suite of experts. About 60 individuals participated across the Gulf, and it allowed us to put that in a quantitative form so we could do the analysis on it. So we looked at three different climate scenarios, and I think we had 58 assessors or 59. So a whole bunch of data, and that all went into a massive spreadsheet. And the results were that the ecosystems were actually, mangrove was the least vulnerable ecosystem, ranging up to tidal emergent marsh, which was the most vulnerable system. And then on the species side, we had the least vulnerable species was blue crab and the most vulnerable Kemp's Ridley sea turtle. And what the process actually enabled us to do also was capture why those vulnerabilities were the way they were, what the input from the species and ecosystem experts indicated. And I want to just back up for a minute. Vulnerability in this case is really looking at the potential impact, so the exposure or sensitivity to those species and ecosystems coupled with their adaptive capacity. So as I mentioned, we did the relative assessment across those ecosystems and species, and really what will enable us to do is identify those areas and the species and ecosystems where the most input is needed now. So how do we get those dollars? As Laura mentioned, resources are really scarce and increasingly more scarce. How do we find the most attention first? So that's really what the vulnerability assessment is trying to do for us. It's led to already to several other studies, including looking at marsh migration, inland marsh migration and urbanization. So where those corridors are, where marsh can migrate inland as sea levels continue to rise, and where there might be pinch points because of existing infrastructure. It also sets the stage for additional work on development of biological objectives, including on species like the black skimmer, which was one of the species we assessed in the Gulf Coast Vulnerability Assessment. We've also cited it in several Restore Act funding proposals, including for the Strategic Conservation Assessment, and also identified in several of the state wildlife action plans, so beginning to actually use it. So I encourage you really to take a look at the GCVA. We're really proud of this work, and we're hoping that it serves as a model for collaboration across large landscapes. I'd also encourage you to take a look at the CCIS website. We're getting prepared for a big summit this fall. It's the 5th anniversary of launching of CCIS, so we're gearing up for a big summit in Baton Rouge this fall. So I'll turn it back to Laura.
Okay, thank you, Cynthia. And I should make a note, since she didn't say it, is that the Gulf Coast Vulnerability Assessment is the recipient of the inaugural Fish and Wildlife Service Award for Transformational Conservation Science. So that was pretty exciting for the team of 50 partners who kind of were the recipients of the award. Does anybody
yes.
have a quick question for Cynthia, or we can hold all questions to the end of the session? Nope. Okay, we'll hold it. We'll hold on, and we'll continue on to the tour and invite Stanton Enomoto up to the stage. He's live with us on the tour to talk about forest bird conservation and the Hawaiian Islands Terrestrial Adaptation Initiative. Stanton brings nearly 25 years of public and private sector experience on cultural, community, environmental, and government affairs to the PIXI team, where he serves as the cultural adaptation coordinator. He's a native Hawaiian who grew up on the islands, and he's seen the changes in Hawaii's environment and is concerned about the effects of climate change on the future his children will inherit. So please, Stanton.
Okay. I don't know if this is okay. Aloha mai kakou. Thank you, Laura, for that introduction. And I wanted to, as Laura mentioned, spend a couple of minutes talking about our work here at the Pacific Islands Climate Change Cooperative. We're the Landscape Conservation Cooperative, as you saw in that big map, that not only covers the lands and waters of the state of Hawaii, but it also extends all the way out into the U.S.-affiliated Pacific. So it includes the territories of Guam, the Northern Marianas, and American Samoa, as well as the freely associated states of Palau, the Federated States of Micronesia, and the Marshall Islands. So we cover a very, very large geography. Our steering committee is made up of a little over 30 different organizations, federal government, state government, non-governmental organizations, academic associations, all with this focus around natural and cultural resource conservation and management. So as our cooperative, when we organized a few years ago, we set out with this mission of really trying to assist those managers, those stewards of cultural and natural resources, on adapting their practices to the impacts of climate change. So within that, I just kind of wanted to highlight one of these efforts that we've been doing. As you can see up here on our story map, and that little bird out there is one of our key and maybe iconic species, the eeve. It's a native honeycreeper. And just for some context, around the time Western contact was made to Hawaii in 1778, there are about 46 species of native birds. And since then till now, we've lost about 26 of them through various changes in environment, changes in their habitat, et cetera. So we're left with 20 species of native forest birds that kind of inhabit some very kind of specialized and unique areas on our islands. Most of them are kind of higher elevation, tucked away from a lot of human contact and other stressors. So I kind of wanted to maybe zoom in a little bit on Hawaii Island and talk about some of the work that we've been doing, or one of our efforts out there. So a few years ago, PIXI brought together a group of scientists, and our research ecologists on staff led the effort to conduct a vulnerability assessment, very similar to what Cynthia talked about, what they were doing out in the Southeast. So we looked at the impacts, the vulnerabilities of native forest birds to climate change, primarily changes in temperature. They're going up. So these birds are very susceptible to avian malaria carried by mosquitoes. And mosquitoes, as we all know, kind of live within a certain temperature band. So on Hawaii Island, we go all the way from sea level up to over 13,000 feet in elevation. So these native forest birds kind of live within kind of these bands in certain parts of the island. So what we're trying to understand, as climate change starts taking hold, as temperatures start to increase, the areas where mosquitoes can live and thrive start to increase in elevation. So it starts to impinge, if you will, on the habitat of these native forest birds, and they can succumb to avian malaria and other diseases. So one of the things that this research effort bore out was that of these 20 species, we identified that about 9 of them to be pretty vulnerable, where they're going to be losing roughly about 75% of their habitat. Of those, you know, another 6 may actually lose almost 90% of their habitat. So what we've identified, I don't know if the map can come up or not. Okay. Well, what we found is that, again, there's certain bands around the summits of these volcanoes where you would see this habitat. It starts to shrink at the lower elevation, and at higher elevation, some habitat starts to expand. So it's a shift, but it's in some areas, it's a progressive decline. Like I had mentioned, some of them may actually lose up to 90% of their habitat. So it's pretty scary for these birds. It's pretty scary for the conservation, the land managers who've been working to protect this habitat. But you know, some of the things that our cooperative is doing now is that it's not all doom and gloom. You know, it's about stepping forward, recognizing that we have some pretty clear threats coming up in the coming years. What are some of the things that we can start to do about it? How can we help these managers adapt their conservation practices so that these birds have a chance? And that's kind of where I wanted to touch on the follow-up effort that Pixie is working on, that our cooperative is working on. And that is that we created this Hawaiian Islands Terrestrial Adaptation Initiative. So again, it's taking scientific information like this vulnerability assessment, looking at the threats to forest birds, and not only forest birds, but native plants and other native species, and thinking about, well, how can we conserve or protect these species in that climate change future as change happens? So we launched this initiative about a year ago with the goal of really trying to bring together the best available science and start having this dialogue with all of these key land management agencies, some state, some federal, some private sector, to start thinking about, okay, what are these impacts? Building that understanding, building that capacity around change that's coming, and then collaboratively start to think about strategies that we can employ to, again, not only help conserve or preserve native bird habitat, but also our native forests. We're struggling with a whole bunch of threats right now in Hawaii to our native species, and it's no one entity can solve everyone's problem. We have to really come together and work collaboratively. So let's see, with this Hawaiian Islands Terrestrial Adaptation Initiative, again, we're bringing folks together to look at that science, have that dialogue. We just started last month with our first dialogue on the island of Maui, but in the coming year, we'll be spreading out to Hawaii Island, Molokai, Oahu, and Kauai. So all of this work is going to be unfolding over the next 12 to 18 months, and we hope to have a much better sense of where things are as we get out into 2018, and hopefully those partnerships will be robust enough that they can carry forward not only within their specific conservation areas, but maybe influence policy at a broad statewide level. So I think maybe I'll stop there. If anyone has a quick question or not, I can pass it back to Lauren. Yes.
I'm just curious, given the great Are the trade winds changing? I mean that's kind of can buffer the standard climate change effect we might have like in mountains in western U.S.
That is one of the things that we're seeing, and some of it is maybe dependent on kind of Pacific systems that are going on. For example, during El Nino or La Nina times, that trade wind inversion gets cut off because of what's happening further out west in the Pacific. So in those times when we lose that trade wind inversion, you know, we start to see a lot more winds coming up out of the south, and yeah, that just changes the temperature a little bit. So it's, I think long term, that's one of the things that we're working with the climate scientists on to, yeah, see how that's going to change. But yeah, trade winds may start shifting in the future. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Stanton. And I should point out the gentleman who asked the question is kind of an LCC insider. Gary Tabor is one of our LCC council members, and he's from the Center for Large Landscapes. So thank you for the question, Gary.
I really was curious.
Yes. So now we're going to go north to Aaron Poe, who is with the Aleutian and Bering Sea Islands LCC. I won't tell you what time it is in Anchorage, Alaska, because obviously I can't do math and got Jackson, Mississippi pretty wrong. But here is Aaron Poe. He is the science coordinator for the Aleutian and Bering Sea Islands LCC, who is about to become the coordinator. Aaron has worked in Alaska for 18 years in wildlife biology, landscape planning, as well as partnership development and community engagement. Much of Aaron's research and management efforts have focused on understanding the relationships between human use and wildlife resources. Take it away, Aaron.
All right, thanks, Laura. You guys hear me okay? I'm looking for thumbs up from the audience. All right, we'll do it. Thanks, guys. Thanks for making me feel like I'm there. Yeah, so thank you very much for inviting me. In fact, before I go any further, I'm really gonna try and feel like I'm there. I have no idea if you guys can see this, but you know, this time of night, it's all about props. So I've got props on for you. I think, Patrick, you've got slide one up where you can see the large orange area that is the Aleutian and Bering Sea Islands LCC. Is that correct?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay, great. So, yeah, so this is the area that we're talking about. And people in communities in that area can literally see Russia from their houses. The leadership of our steering committee is composed of 5 federal agencies, 3 NGOs, and 2 Alaska Native tribes. And basically, some of the things I tell people about this region that they might want to care about is that 50% of US seafood comes from that part of the world. So as you're approaching dinner time there in Hawaii, that might be important to you. If you live in that region, it's certainly important to you because it's the heart of your economy. It's the heart of your traditional harvesting lifestyle or subsistence lifestyle, as we say up here. And so the 9 or so communities that are in this region are really dependent on the resources there. They're some of the most remote communities in the United States. Certainly are really in touch with the ecosystem and the environment. It's in a tremendously productive area for marine mammals, for seabirds. So really a pretty special part of the planet. And just like other LCCs, the Aleutian Bering Sea Islands LCC has done a lot of focused work on climate change, but we also look into other topics. And so, Patrick, if I can get you to go click on tile 18 there. Hopefully that's coming up. And as you'll see, it turns out that one of the big topics of concern in this region is marine vessel traffic. So between the two continents, between North America and Asia, there's been basically a trade route for hundreds of years. And this trade route now has manifested itself in sort of a large industrial sense, like this ship that you see broken apart there on the side of the screen. That was the Sellindung Ayu that broke apart in December of 2004. It spilled its cargo, its fuel, actually loss of life. There were 6 crew members that perished in this accident. And it really got folks' attention in that region that, wow, we have a major shipping route that cuts right through the heart of a pretty isolated place where there really isn't response capability. And so we got this task force form that called the Aleutian Islands Risk Assessment. They predated the LCC, but it turns out we had a pretty common interest and we were able to come through with a critical piece of data for them. And so this kind of swirling mass of colors that you see at the center of the screen there, that is a summary of satellite locations for large vessel traffics running through the region based on satellite transponders that these vessels have to carry. So any vessel over 300 tons that's transiting the world's oceans has to have what's called an AIS transponder on it. And basically satellites can receive the signals from those transponders. And so doing an analysis of that data, we were able for the first time to really show where are the traffic areas that are cutting right through this heart of the Aleutians. And so those areas in red that you see there, basically those pictures, those images that are running by are monthly summaries of vessel traffic. And so you see those pretty static red lines running right through the heart of the Aleutians. Well, that ended up being where the major vessel routes were. So we were able to provide that information to this existing working group. They were able to go to the International Maritime Organization. And Patrick, if you scroll down to kind of the next photo, you see this sort of gray shaded out area. It kind of tells the story there a little bit, gives it away. But basically, the International Maritime Organization, the IMO, was able to establish areas to be avoided, five of these across much of the Aleutians, based on our data set. And they were able to basically show that, hey, if vessels that are transiting this region, if you guys were able to stay at this possible distance, you'll basically decrease your likelihood of maybe running aground or causing some kind of incident in the region. If you keep scrolling down there, Patrick, you'll see some pictures of these handsome fellows, stellar sea lions, northern sea otters. If you run all the way down to the bottom, you'll see these dapper dudes, horned puffins. So basically, as I mentioned, this is a really productive, sensitive area in terms of marine species. So we were able to do a kind of a proxy for risk or a distance analysis to basically look at the change in those routes, those vessel routes, relative to these seabird colonies, relative to sea lion haulouts, northern sea otter concentration areas, and basically able to show kind of the vessels transiting this region and to show the International Maritime Organization that, hey, you have a significant reduction in risk if you back those vessels off away from the islands a little bit. So, and actually, Patrick, I'm having you do kind of hijinks here, but if you run back up to that picture with the areas to be avoided, you'll notice in the top kind of left, there's a caption that says April 2016. Well, those areas to be avoided went into effect on January of this year. And already those yellow lines that you see, you guessed it, that's contemporary traffic. The red lines that are cutting through the middle of it, those are those former routes, those routes that you see on the image that's kind of flashing there next to you. Those were the former routes through the Aleutian. Well, now we've been able to, with this work, push those boats that much further away from these islands, reducing risk to those species. So we're pretty proud of this work. It maybe is a little bit different than some of the stuff that LCCs have traditionally done, but it certainly was a key role that we were able to play in the region. And maybe I'll leave it there, other than to say, scroll all the way to the bottom, Patrick. I've got you on your toes, I know it. At ABCLCC on Twitter. Somebody please tweet me a picture on this wall. I have no idea what it looks like. And then check out our website, absillcc.org. And thank you, guys.
Thank you, Aaron. So did anybody get a photo? All right, we got some photos. So we'll tweet you. And
thank you.
Yes, and Aaron is actually very productive on Twitter, and he's fun to follow, so I'll throw a promo your way. And you can always follow the LCC Network, too, on Twitter at National LCC Network. And so we have a few minutes left. I'd love it if we could bring up a couple chairs, and Deanna and Stanton, and then we have Aaron and Cynthia to answer your questions, or I have questions as well. So we can get a dialogue going and have our own kind of gathering here right now. So in the audience, does anybody have a question for one of our tour guides? Okay.
You guys. Oh, we just need two chairs.
My name is Craig Schaefer, and one of our speakers, I forget which, indicated that one of the goals of the cooperatives was the impacts of habitat fragmentation, and there was a concern to try to retain habitat connectivity. One of the things I've been concerned about for a long time and have written about is the habitat fragmentation that's going on outside our protected areas. And it seems to me that these cooperatives would be an ideal opportunity to invite state, local county land use planners to be part of the cooperative, and then have, rather than just share and give them technical information that you may have compiled, to actually help them in their land use planning, with conservation being the objective, and to retain habitat connectivity. Are there any examples you can think of where this is happening in any of the cooperatives, where, you know, someone in the cooperative and somebody in the county land use planners are sitting down at the same table and saying, you know, I would recommend this type of land use plan because we don't want habitat fragmentation here, and so on and so forth?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I think we could probably say that for just about every, if not every, landscape conservation cooperative. Cynthia, with your experience in the Southeast, anything you'd like to add to that? To add?
So, Laura, I can't really hear the questions from the audience very well. Can you just repeat it quickly?
Yeah, so talking about partnership with land use planning organizations to really think about how you do conservation planning and the types of organizations that come together through an LCC.
Sure. So in the Southeast, even though we're rolling the six conservation cooperatives up to the Southeast Conservation Adaptation Strategy Blueprint, each of those entities is unique. Each of them are self-directed, as Laura mentioned, and have different partnerships depending on what the needs are in that particular geographic location. So I think one of the most pertinent things from my perspective is making sure that you have the conversation, that you have the right people in the room, that it's a place where you can have those discussions and you can agree on things and sometimes disagree on approaches. But I think really what the most important thing is finding that sweet spot where you might not agree, entities might not agree on everything. We've got lots of state and federal partners as well as NGO thing, ranging from large national NGOs like the Nature Conservancy to smaller, more localized entities. So there's a large difference in scale, but it's really about finding that sweet spot where people can come together and identify those areas where it does make sense for us to work together. And those conversations are really important because those blueprints don't make sense to the partners unless they can see their own values and goals reflected in them. And that does take, it does take a lot of time, but it's really, when it's working well, it really is worth the effort. And I think really sets the stage for that collaborative conservation that we need to have in order to make a difference. So I hope that answered your question.
Gary. And I think, you know, as we're getting a mic to Gary, I think you raise a great point, which is it's about process as much as it is about product or delivering decision support tool products. Yeah.
So, Craig, is that right? So, Craig, I'd say the answer to your question is depends what region of the country. I think in the Northeast and the Southeast, it's much more engaged with the states and reaches down to the county level. I think in the West, the counties have Western County kind of approach, which is more independence and less engagement with federal. Because wildlife is considered in many parts of the country to be a state asset, not necessarily a federal asset, that gets to be an interesting point of conversation in the Western United States. However, the states have regionalized a lot of their work through what they call CHAT, or the Western Governors Association. And the LCCs are using the CHAT information in building their landscape conservation designs. So they are deferring to the states on information. And I think it's that old history of federal, state, and maybe even local tensions. I think the LCCs are working to create a new model that tries to move beyond that.
Great. Any more? We have a question.
You know, just to add on to the challenges, You know, the LCCs are based on ecosystems and not on jurisdictional boundaries, which is a good thing. But I've actually seen that to be problematic. Some states include three LCCs, and I've seen that become an issue. Also, there's the Cooperative Ecosystem Studies Units, which are generally, it was started out with academia, but they have multiple members as well. And they engage with the local state and county planners as well as NGOs. So my question is, how does a LCC interface with a CESU, a Cooperative Ecosystem Studies Unit? And then just to aggravate things, your LCCs cross regional boundaries of the Fish and Wildlife Service, regional boundaries of the Forest Service. It sounds great in concept, but crossing all those jurisdictional boundaries makes it challenging, I'm sure. So my question goes back to the CESUs. What are you dealing with the CESUs?
I think Deanna will take a stab at that.
I'll take a stab at that. So it depends on which LCC, but most LCCs, when we were established, we reached out to existing partnerships in our regions of the world. And so sometimes it was the Cooperative Ecosystem Study Units, sometimes it was the Migratory Bird Joint Venture partnerships. In this part of the world, there are other types of partnerships very specific to the Pacific Islands that don't exist on the North American continent. Both Cynthia and Aaron mentioned existing partnerships that their efforts are building on. And so that's really the model, is not to try to compete with or replace, but to bring value added to those partnerships, to work cooperatively with them when needed and when not, to focus on something different so that we are filling those critical gaps at addressing the very big, large landscape issues. But I know for our LCC, working with the CESU is important, as well as these other partnerships. It's very important for us to be able to get our work done. It's a very large region. We don't have many resources, and we can't afford to be competitive about these kinds of issues.
Okay, we have a question in the back. So Deanna, you know, talking about being unique and complementary, I think is really one of the core values of the LCCs, with working with partners, Climate Science Center, CESUs, joint ventures, fish habitat partnerships. Question.
Hi there. Penelope Figgis from Australia, where we're extremely keen on the whole concept of large-scale landscape conservation, et cetera. I'm just interested, how much do you actually press the whole idea of sort of connectivity of the chunks, if you like? We have both the concept of connectivity, but the concept we also push is permeability. In other words, the allowance of ecosystem processes, like, for example, flooding, you know, which might be incredibly important ecologically to maintain a floodplain system. And it may not mean that you have to buy every property or try to secure some sort of covenant or easement over every property. So I'm just interested in your sort of ecological concepts, whether it's sort of connecting all the pieces or whether it is sort of ecological processes.
Okay, I'm going to sound like a broken record. It depends on the LCC. So for example, here in the Pacific Islands and also in the Caribbean Islands, ecological connectivity is a big problem because it brings invasive competitors. And so what we try to do is focus on how do we keep the intact remaining native ecosystems, which are very, very small in proportion to the large invaded systems. How do we keep them intact and try to restore connectivity very carefully, as opposed to someplace like in many of the Western LCCs, where you've got large migratory mammals who need to be roaming over across many, many jurisdictions. And so there's a program that was spearheaded by the Western Governors Association that many of the LCCs have been part of,
called crucial habitat areas, where basically everybody's working together to figure out where are these large migratory pathways, how do we map across jurisdictions so that data sets connect with each other, how do we plan renewable energy projects so that we're not cutting across migratory corridors. And then you go up to the Northern Boreal LCC, which is United States, Canada, and they're not looking at so much issues around fragmentation and connectivity. What they're looking at is they have mostly intact ecosystems that are going through a complete biome shift because of climate change. And so what they're looking at is how do we facilitate that shift in a way that is helpful for those native species that can actually adapt to those changes. And so again, it depends on which ecological region you're in, what the major stressors are, what the major challenges are, and what the partners want to voluntarily tackle, because we're not regulatory. It's all voluntary. It's all, you know, how do we pull together our resources and figure out, is it a connectivity issue?
And I just wanted to check, Aaron or Cynthia, did you want to add anything about ecological connectivity before we take another question?
Deanna got my line. I was going to plug the Northwest Boreal LCC. Okay. Well, that really is their big focus right now.
Great. All right, next question from our audience.
Well, I'm not sure exactly how to phrase this question, but I get it is the Northwest Boreal. I wonder how the ice fields above the Arctic ice fields are treated as landscape, and if a lot of the impact that you've seen on shipping is due to reduced ice field extent that has allowed commercial shipping above Canada.
Aaron, were you able to?
I got ice field and I got commercial shipping, so I knew it was coming to me, but I didn't catch much of the rest of it. If you could repeat, Deanna, that'd be great.
So I think it is about kind of the melting of the ice shields and how that's affecting shipping and shipping routes.
Yeah, I think I've got it. But I mean, that graphic that I had up on the screen, I didn't go into the detail on it. But certainly that's one of the big things that folks are concerned about up here, is that for many, many months of the year, you actually can't run a vessel up through the Arctic Ocean. But that window of basically the ocean being open is expanding by months. And so basically there's communities up there that have never had contact with things like cruise ships showing up and, you know, asking for some kind of support or facilities. And there's species up there that haven't interacted with these large vessels. So it's definitely a challenge that's at the top of mind for a lot of folks in Alaska and in northern Canada as well.
But it's not just the shipping, though. It's also about the coastal resiliency as well for those Alaskan coastal
Yeah, there's definitely, I mean, basically the loss of sea ice as a feature on the landscape has a lot of repercussions, you know, for, as you mentioned, the coastal resilience. Basically, you have increased flooding, increased coastal erosion without those ice barriers to protect the shoreline. You know, a lot of the species that, of course, you know, things like polar bears obviously are kind of the poster child, but there's certainly many, many other species that are dependent on that ice field being there.
We have another question up front.
Hi, Stacy Butte from Phoenix, Arizona. I believe our desert LCC is operated through Bureau of Reclamation, is that right?
Okay, yep, that's right.
We've worked to connect with them. We're having some success at the local level in Maricopa County, working with local officials on wildlife connectivity, specifically with all the development activities happening in far western Maricopa County. But I would love to connect with our desert LCC to link into some of that more local work. And I'm curious, who do I get in touch with?
Well, to put in the plug, if you go to our website at lccnetwork.org, there's an about where you can drop down all of our LCCs. And there's contact information for every coordinator. And in this case, in the desert LCC, it's Genevieve Johnson. And then every science coordinator, as well as if an LCC has additional staff like a communications person, a GIS person like Patrick, and so you can find all of that information plus how to go to their individual and unique websites. So you can find, and then you can always come talk to us and we'll help connect you up. I think we probably have time for one more question. Yes.
Hey, aloha mai, Stanton. Po mai kai, kanepio Crozier with Pu'uhui Watershed Preserve. First of all, mahalo nui for all your great work on Maui and in Hawaii with Pixie. My question is, unlike some of the other areas, the micro habitat and climates, you know, in Hawaii are so close. Sometimes you range from the second wettest spot on Earth, half hour drive is less rain than the Kalahari Desert, you know, in just such a short distance. And through the fragmentation and connectivity that we're trying to do, what do you hope would come out that we know we'll have to address people impact, because everybody is visitors in Hawaii, and what role that might be taken into account with what we're doing in Hawaii?
Yeah, that's the million-dollar question, multi-million-dollar question. I think from Pixie's perspective, you know, as we go through this adaptation initiative process and bring together conservation folks, communities, what have you, I guess for me, my thinking is that it would be through that dialogue that some of those solutions start to emerge, or at least directions emerge. I mean, just like we have real fragmentation and rapid change in our kind of biomes or geographies, same thing, as you know, with our communities. So communities on East Maui, different than West Maui or what have you. So I think these, just like we come up with adaptation strategies, we're going to have to come up with community-specific strategies, and they're going to have to be a big part of that conversation going forward. So it's something that we recognize here, not only in Hawaii, but we're seeing it elsewhere in the Pacific. Everything is local. There's no one-size-fits-all, and you can't implement an effective conservation strategy without having that conversation with the very people that live there, right? So we gotta work to bring as many people as we can and develop that network to, yeah, start coming up with some answers.
Okay, well, thank you very much, everybody, for joining us again. You can access our LCC Network story map if you go to lccnetwork.org. It's on our homepage, and we'll stand, be towards the side if you have any more questions. But thank you for joining us, and I hope you have a great rest of your conference. Mahalo.